unfortunately. Well, we're going to wrap up our post-Easter series on life after death. After exploring reincarnation and hell and judgment day, today we turn on to the much happier topic of heaven and eternal life. We're going to be turning to Revelation chapter 21, 1 through 5, and then 9 through 25. Here we have John, who is trying to do his best to marshal human language to describe what eternal life will be like. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away." And the one who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." He also said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." And then moving ahead to verse 9. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and said to me, "Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." And in the spirit he carried me away to a great high mountain, and he showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. It has the glory of God and a radiance like a very rare jewel, like jasper, clear as crystal. It has a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and on the gates are inscribed the names of the 12 tribes of the Israelites. On the east there are three gates, on the north there are three gates, on the south three gates, on the west three gates. And the wall of the city has 12 foundations, and on them are the 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. The angel who talked to me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city and its gates and its walls. The city lies four square, its length the same as its width, and he measured the city with his rod, 1,500 miles. Its length and its width and its height are equal. He also measured its wall, 150 cubits by human measurement, which the angel was using. The wall is built of jasper, while the city is pure gold, clear as glass. The foundations of the wall of the city are adorned with every jewel. The first was jasper, the second sapphire, the third agate, the fourth emerald, the fifth onyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, and the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. The 12 gates are 12 pearls. Each of the gates is a single pearl, and the streets of the city are pure gold, transparent as glass. I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God is its light. And its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. Its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
How do we describe the indescribable? Yet that is exactly our job this morning as we attempt to describe what heaven will be like and why it matters. Joseph Bailey, in his wonderful little book Heaven, for instance, points out how difficult it would be to describe or explain eating a pineapple to an Eskimo in the Arctic Circle. Think about that. Try to imagine explaining what a pineapple tastes like to an Eskimo. Sweet, juicy blubber is about as close as you could probably come to it, and if you think about it, that doesn't quite do justice to the experience of eating a pineapple, does it? Or how could a twin who was born go back into the womb and explain what he saw in the delivery room to the unborn twin? Or how could he describe the Rocky Mountains, or the sky on a starry night, or the beach at a sunset to their unborn brother? Words could only hint, right, at the glory about to await that unborn child. And so it is for the biblical writers as they try to communicate what heaven will be like to us. As Paul says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no human heart has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. And yet, here's the problem. All we have is hearts and eyes and ears. And so the Bible does its best through poetry and imagery to give us glimpses of what God has prepared in heaven. It starts, interestingly enough, with Genesis in the Garden of Eden, where the biblical writers tell us what life would have been like if we wouldn't have messed everything up by trying to do it our own way. If the Garden of Eden is paradise lost, then heaven is the Garden of Eden regained. So what can we learn from heaven according to Genesis 2 and 3? Well, first, we learn that there will be companionship and friendship in heaven. Adam and Eve were given each other as companions and helpers to serve each other. Companionship, a friendship, camaraderie, community. Revelation 21 makes the same point by picturing heaven not as a garden, but rather as a city, and a very large city at that. 2.25 million square miles, in fact. That's one half of a big city. The point is there's room for you. There's room for me. There's room for all. One thing we know about cities, of course, is that there's lots of people in them, right? And so the Bible is bookended with promises of community, of fellowship. By the way, for those who don't like cities, just keep reading on to Revelation chapter 22, where we see the tree of life and the Garden of Eden return as part of the heavenly city. So, as somebody in one of my disciple classes once commented, heaven will be kind of like New York City with the Central Park in the middle, but of course no muggers. The other thing we learned from Genesis is that there will be work in heaven, but it won't be like work as we currently experience it most of the time. It'll be more like play. Remember that Adam and Eve were assigned the job of tilling and keeping the garden, but that this job didn't become toil or labor or quote-unquote work until they sinned and were put outside of the garden. While they were in the garden, it was a joy to do their own work. It was satisfying. It wasn't frustrating. And so work will be pleasant again in heaven. And I don't know about you, but that's good news to me. Because the popular image that we have of heaven in our culture is that we're all going to sit around on clouds all day listening to angels play harp music, right? Now, if you love harp music, maybe you are a harpsichordist in your life on earth, that would be heavenly, no pun intended. But for the rest of it, us, it probably sounds rather dull. Me, I want to keep growing. I want to keep developing. So, when we get to heaven, or you get to heaven, how would you like to have God give you a tour of the universe and explain its inner workings to you? That sounds like an interesting time. Maybe you want to help God run the black holes for a day or two. Or maybe you want to study the inner workings of the atom. Or maybe you want to learn to yodel or bake bread or understand the federal tax code. God have mercy on you if that's what you want to do in heaven. But I suppose all of it is possible. The next stop in the biblical preview of heaven is the Old Testament's vision of the messianic age that we encounter in the prophets. These visions also describe heaven for us. In Isaiah chapter 2, for instance, the prophet describes the time when swords will be beaten into plowshares and when spears will be turned into pruning hooks. There will be no more war in heaven. There will be no conflict at all. Revelation says the same thing when it says that the gates will be open all day. There's no threat of danger in it. All creation, in fact, will live in perfect harmony in heaven. Isaiah 11, 6 through 8, for instance, gives us this portrait of the messianic kingdom. He says, the wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, and the lion and the yearling will be together. Peace. Harmony. Things restored to the way they were intended. Some may wonder, will there be pets in heaven? Will I meet my dog or cat? Who's to say? But I think there's good hope for that. The Bible's picture is of a new heaven and a new earth. In Revelation 21:5, God says, behold, I am making all things new. Note that it does not say, behold, I am making all new things. You see the difference? God is in the recycling business. God is in the redemption business. God is going to make all things new. Why? Because all of creation, including Fido and Tigger, matter to God. Matter matters to God, in fact. God loves creation. After all, God made it. And so in Revelation, the earth doesn't go up into heaven. No, heaven, the new Jerusalem, comes down, right, into this world. Because this world, people, animals, plants, all of it matter to God. By the way, if it all matters to God, it all ought to matter to us, which means that we ought to be at the forefront of the environmental movement as believers and followers in Jesus Christ. But I digress here. Jesus and his ministry gives us our next glimpse of the coming attractions in the heavenly realm. As Pastor Steve Richards says, Jesus tells us many things about what God's kingdom will be like. That the last will be first, and the first will be last. There's going to be surprises in heaven. Who's there? Who's not? Right? That to be in heaven, we must become like children. Not childish, but that we must become trusting like children. Our kids that we saw today. We've got to be willing to fly around like foolish butterflies. And in John 14, Jesus says, in my Father's house there are many rooms. And that he is going ahead to prepare a place specially for each of us. In Jesus' resurrection body, we get a glimpse of what our heavenly bodies might possibly be like. They appear like our earthly bodies, because after all, the disciples recognized Jesus, right? But they also, as Jesus' body did, had the ability to appear and reappear, apparently at will. Here's another great thing we learned from Jesus. It seems, who really knows, but it seems that we're going to be able to enjoy food in heaven. Let's hear it for that, huh? Remember how Jesus made a point of eating a piece of fish with Thomas? I mean, after all, what would be the point of a heavenly banquet, right, if you couldn't taste the food, huh? No calories, I'm sure. Through Jesus' miracles, we also catch a glimpse of the coming kingdom. Each miracle of Jesus is done so that we will see God's kingdom kingdom breaking into the earthly ground. The blind will see, the lame will walk, the lepers will be cleansed, those who are mentally ill will be made whole. Children born with diseases and disabilities will be made completely whole. There will be no disease or sorrow or pain in the Bible, in heaven, according to the Bible. The Apostle Paul makes the same point in his letters. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, for instance, he says that our perishable bodies will put on imperishability. And that our mortal bodies will put on immortality, and death will be swallowed up in victory. Now, as seen, I hope, from my frequent references to it, you'll discover that the book of Revelation says amen to what Paul and Jesus and the prophets and Genesis all say. But Revelation wants us to be absolutely clear about what the very best thing will be about heaven. We haven't gotten to that yet. The best thing about heaven, according to the book of Revelation, will not be meeting Fido, or getting new bodies, or continuing to learn or to grow, or even being reunited with our loved ones. That's all good stuff, but it's not the best stuff. The best stuff will be the fulfillment, finally, of God's promise to be our God and to live with us in unbroken, unbridled fellowship. That's the best thing about heaven according to the scriptures. Behold, says the loud voice from the heavens in Revelation, the home of God is among mortals. God will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. God will be with us in heaven. Now, says Paul in another place in 1 Corinthians, now we see in a mirror dimly. We can't see God clearly, but then he says, we shall see as face to face. That which God has begun in Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, right, will be brought to completion in heaven, unbroken fellowship with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And so Revelation chapter 21, verse 22. My, this is a meaty sermon, isn't it? Revelation 21, 22 says, I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. That's Jesus, the Lamb of God. Why, in John's description of heaven, is there no temple? Because all heaven is a temple. We won't have to go to church in heaven. Heaven will be church. That's why the whole book of Revelation is jammed full of worship and singing. Glorious worship and singing. Because everything in heaven will be rendered to God as praise. Our bodies, our work, our relationship, all of it will become praise in heaven. That, by the way, is why regular corporate worship is so important. Because it's preparing us for life in heaven. Perhaps heaven, like eating green beans, is a bit of an acquired taste. And if we haven't acquired that taste on earth, well, then maybe we may get to heaven and say, well, thank you very much, but that's just not my cup of tea. And we talked about that in some other sermons, haven't we? As someone once said, some people rejoice that they will receive their reward of living in heaven with Jesus. Other people rejoice that they will live in Jesus, in heaven with Jesus, who is their reward. I'll repeat that one more time. Some people rejoice that they will receive their reward of living in heaven with Jesus, but others rejoice that they will live in heaven with Jesus, who is their reward. So the first reason that heaven matters right now is that we need to get ready for it. So that what our heart longs for, so that who our heart longs for, will actually be there when we arrive. The second reason that heaven matters is that heaven is the blueprint for our work here on earth. We begin with the end in our lives. That's why Jesus taught us to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." Where? On earth, as it is in heaven. Every week we pray that. Our job, dear friend, is to bring as much of heaven down to earth as we possibly can during our lives. If there's no hunger in heaven, then we ought to work to eliminate hunger on earth. If all are equal in heaven, then we ought to treat all people as equal here on earth. If all are healed in heaven, then we ought to bring as much healing to humanity as we possibly can here on earth. We take our marching orders, dear friends, not from the mass media, not from the government, not from the Republicans or the Democrats. We take our marching order from our Father, whose will is done in heaven, perfectly. Finally, belief in heaven matters because the hope of eternal life enables us to live bold, courageous, faithful lives here on earth. I always get a kick out of the "so what" that the Bible gives to the doctrine of heaven. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, for instance, Paul spends a whole chapter just waxing poetic about the beauty of heaven and the glories of God's defeat of death. But here's the conclusion that Paul gives to that whole chapter. He says, "Therefore, my beloved, be steadfast, be immovable, always excelling in the work of the Lord, because you know that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." That's the "so what." Why does heaven matter? It matters because those who believe in life after death are steadfast and movable in life before death. When all hell breaks loose on earth, it is the promise of heaven that lashes the believer to the mast of the ship so that he or she can keep sailing despite the storms. When our loved one is gone and our heart is broken, it's the hope of heaven that enables us to stay faithful and steadfast while we're still here on earth. When the doctor says it's cancer and it's malignant and there's nothing they can do, it's the hope of heaven that helps us face the end with courage and with dignity. I have walked through the valley of the shadow of death with numerous people in my 26 years of ministry. And I have seen this reality, this hope of heaven as an anchor of the soul, prove true time and time and time again. Believers may indeed be afraid, they may waffle some, but God gives courage. And believers face death unlike non-believers. They are steadfast, and they are immovable in the storm. Why does heaven matter? It matters because those that believe in heaven are most inspired to stay faithful here on earth. I remember when I left my first church in Glassboro, New Jersey, I was so disappointed because the church really began to struggle after Rebecca and I left. And then to add to that discouragement, I learned that they closed their doors this Easter just a few weeks ago. And it's tempting. It's tempting to think that my 9 years there, working like a dog, to build up the kingdom of God in those people and in that city, was wasted. But you know what? Now I realize that that thought that it's useless. If that is a thought straight from the mouth of hell, you know that in the Lord, your labor is not in vain, says Paul. It's not in vain. So often, tell me if I'm the only one, but so often in our lives, things seem to fizzle, don't they? So often we are left racking our brains and going, "Oh, that worked, and you know, it's just not flying. So often it seems that nobody cares or nobody notices. So often it seems like our lives aren't making any difference whatsoever. It is easy, isn't it, to give up, to stop trying when you think that that's true, right? But Jesus says that not even a cup of water given in His name will be wasted. Anytime, dear friends, we do anything that affects other people for the good, the angels in heaven notice and they applaud. Anytime we do anything that sends up even the slightest ripple of love or justice on planet Earth, God notices. And the kingdom of God advances, and one more little treasure is stored up for us in heaven. And when we get there, we will be greeted by those that we have affected for the good. We will be greeted by our loved ones in the Lord. Many of you know that Thursday morning, early in the middle of the night, I got the call that everybody dreads to get. You know, when you get that call at 1:30, that it's something really is wrong. Got a call from my brother Dick saying that my brother John had been out on Wednesday night on the tennis court playing tennis and he collapsed. The doctors were working on him, but it didn't look good. And then it was confirmed he didn't make it. That was it. And I can't tell you how I long to see my brother John in heaven again. But even more than that, I long to see Jesus welcoming all of His children with open arms. I'm homesick for heaven. Friends, this world is not our home. Don't make it your home. Don't live here. We are just passing through. And I can't wait to get to the other side. But in the meantime, God gives us a foretaste of the life to come here in the Lord's Supper, which is a precursor of that great heavenly banquet. Here in the bread and in the wine, here in the community of faith gathered in love, we experience a preview of heaven. Love, community, satisfaction, peace. And so we give thanks. Eucharistia, it means to give thanks. This table, we give thanks. We give thanks to God for the hope of heaven and strength to live well here on earth. As our choir comes forward, let us pray. Graciously, Heavenly Father, you know the ache of our hearts, the ache of being separated from those that we love, the fear that we face ourselves as we face the end of our lives. And so you give us the promise of eternal life in Christ Jesus. Thank you, gracious God. We need, Lord, to begin with the end. Help us to live with courage and bravery and love and compassion here on earth as it shall be one day in heaven. Grant us joy, that we might join with the choir of angels as we lay down our crowns before Jesus' throne and proclaim happily, Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.